Good afternoon and welcome to everybody. Welcome to our OSFI Small and Medium-Sized Banking Risk Management Webcast. I'm Brigitte Faneuf. I'm the Senior Director of our Small and Medium-Sized Banking Group, and it's my pleasure today to be your virtual host. As we go through sessions today, you will hear from OSFI's experts on a range of topics we suspect are top of mind in the current environment. But before we begin, I'd like to share a few housekeeping notes with you. The presentation and agenda are available for download on the webcast page. We want this to be an interactive session, so we encourage you to ask and vote for questions on Slido. Please go to slido.com in another browser on your mobile device and enter the code 26933 and the password is OSFIBSIF29. We will have 3 questions period today, one after each group of presenters. That means one after financial risk, non-financial risk, and data. If we run out of time or cannot answer your questions, we will circulate a list of those questions and the responses to all of you via email. Today's presenters will be speaking in both official languages. You can choose to hear the audio and see the slide in the language of your choice. If you are watching on the English channel, you will hear interpretation in English for any French that is spoken. If you are watching on the French channel, you will hear interpretation in French for any English that is spoken. If you do not want to hear any interpretation, click floor audio at the bottom left corner of your screen. You can click the Français or Anglais button in the top right corner of your screen to switch channels at any time. If you need technical assistance, please chat with tech support with the button at the top of your screen. There will be a 10-minute break at 1:50 p.m. And lastly, we are recording this webcast and the video will be available on our YouTube channel in the coming weeks. With that, I'd like to introduce OSFI's Assistant Superintendent of Deposit Taking Supervision Sector, Jamie Hobbs, who will give us some opening remarks. Jamie, over to you.
Merci beaucoup, Brigitte. Et messieurs, merci à tous vous joindre.
Thank you, Brigitte, and thank you for joining us today. I'll be speaking briefly, if you allow me to go through the presentation and then address any questions.
Webcast was held in January 2020. A few months before COVID-19 began to affect all of our respective organizations and us personally. This past year has been incredibly challenging, and the pandemic has certainly put the resilience of the Canadian financial institutions to the test. Through the pandemic, Canada's small and medium-sized banks have served an integral role in the resilience of our financial sector and our communities. You've worked closely with the official sector to ensure customers have had the support they need to navigate the crisis, including lending support, loan deferrals, and advice. At the time, banks entered the pandemic well-placed in terms of capital and liquidity. As the pandemic progressed, it is clear that banks had enhanced their operational resilience as well as bolstering capital and liquidity levels. Banks have, to date, managed their risk and adjusted effectively under incredible pressure. Banks were ready with developed business continuity plans that allowed them to carry out their essential services uninterrupted. Banks also managed the deferral programs effectively through the fall of 2020, and the concerns of a deferral cliff did not materialize as originally thought. As well, the original concerns of potential liquidity crisis turned into a situation where banks' liquidity levels actually increased as 2020 progressed. The prudential preparations, in tandem with the extraordinary actions that the Government of Canada has taken to support the economy and the financial markets, have helped maintain confidence in the financial system throughout this difficult period. It is clear that banks have responded well. Nevertheless, it is equally clear that the environment going forward has become more complex. Before we go forward, let's take a quick look back. This time last year, we are operating with an unprecedented and volatile environment. The industry was contending with not only a global pandemic, but also a global oil price war. At the height of the pandemic, OSFI acted quickly by refocusing our efforts to support operational capacity and resilience at financial institutions. Part of that effort included introducing temporary regulatory measures and pausing our policy development and consultation work until institutions had some experience operating in this new environment. As both the industry and OSFI gained more experience, we moved cautiously to restart our policy work and, where appropriate, step back some of the measures put in place. Some of these measures continue to apply, and we assess them regularly for relevance. Stay tuned, as we are hopeful that as stabilization continues, that we can unwind more measures throughout the near term. Now, just a year from the first lockdown, COVID-19 continues to have real impacts on people's lives and the economy. Although there is renewed optimism with the rollout of vaccines and an improving economic outlook, we need to remain vigilant. The exact trajectory of the pandemic and the residual impacts are unknown. Government supports today have been crucial in stabilizing families, businesses, and the economy more broadly. Yet, how long will those last? What are the impacts when these supports wind down? These are important questions we are asking, and questions banks should be asking as well. With an uncertain future ahead, readiness is key. Banks need to continue to be proactive, risk-focused, and examine their risk profiles through the lens of the pandemic and consider multiple scenarios. It is also noteworthy that none of the risk issues we were concerned about before the pandemic have gone away. And so this work continues as well. Two areas of risk of note are technology and climate. It is no coincidence that as soon as we resumed consultations in 2020, we led with two discussion papers on these very topics. COVID-19 threatens the public health, and in turn changed our physical environment, forcing us to rely on technology more than ever, magnifying existing technology risks. Banks have shifted well to their digital environments, but with this resilience on technology, firms need to remain vigilant to potential data threats and weaknesses in their digital environments. Turning to the risks related to climate change, at OSFI, we have ramped up our efforts to better understand and prepare for the prudential impacts of climate-related risks may have on the financial sector. One example of this work is the pilot scenario analysis project we are undertaking with the Bank of Canada and some Canadian financial institutions. We are seeking to better understand the risk associated with the transition to a low greenhouse gas economy. The pandemic has revealed new risks and heightened concerns relating to existing ones, and they all will require attention and action. Today's speakers can shed light on our planned actions going forward and any questions you may have. Merci, je suis la parole à Brigitte, qui va présenter.
Now I'll give the floor to Brigitte, who will be talking about liquidity.
Today's presentation with a discussion on financial risks. As a reminder, please send your question in via Slido during the presentation. We will take questions after the third presentation. Steve Bivington, our Managing Director of Bank Capital, will start by discussing Basel III implementation in our new tailored approach to capital and liquidity requirements for smaller and less complex banks. Steve?
Good day, everyone, et bonjour à tous. Thank you, Brigitte and Jamie, for your introduction, and I'm very pleased to have an opportunity to present during today's webcast to small and medium-sized banking institutions, as well as a range of other participants from federal and provincial bodies. My name is Steve Bevington, and I'm a member of the banking team in OSFI's Capital Division. During my comments today, I'll provide a brief overview of a significant consultation that is currently ongoing in relation to OSFI's domestic implementation of the final Basel III reforms, the launch of a brand new draft guideline to introduce a set of more explicitly proportional capital and liquidity requirements for SMSBs, and solicit input from stakeholders regarding the future set of Pillar 3 disclosure requirements for these institutions. My comments will briefly cover the scope of the consultations, touch on some of the key policy proposals that are encompassed within the various guidelines, outline the new requirements for SMSBs, and conclude by outlining some expected milestones between now and the point of implementation for the new requirements in Q1 2023. Next slide, please. So in a nutshell, what are the consultations about? Well, as you've hopefully seen, on March 11th, we launched a public consultation related to proposed regulatory changes to introduce the final round of Basel III reforms, as well as address a number of other policy matters not associated with Basel III. The proposed revisions will impact a number of sections of OSFI's capital adequacy requirements, or CAR, liquidity adequacy requirements, or LAR, and leverage requirements guidelines. As well, OSFI will be proposing changes to tailor its capital and liquidity regimes to ensure that it remains appropriate for smaller, less complex deposit-taking institutions. Together, the proposed changes to OSFI guidance will help foster a more resilient and risk-sensitive regulatory regime that both adheres to the Basel III framework as well as incorporates important adjustments to reflect the Canadian market. Now, as you may recall, our plan had initially been to launch these consultations in the spring of 2020. However, given the sudden onset of the pandemic, we deferred this, along with a number of other prudential policy consultations, but we've since returned our focus to these important policy matters. Next slide. Together, the guidelines and chapters that we're currently consulting on constitute a very significant and wide-reaching set of revisions to the capital and liquidity frameworks, as well as the Pillar 3 disclosure guideline for systemically important banks. As most of you are aware, there have already been a number of Basel III-related changes incorporated into the federal regulatory framework over the past several years. These have included the introduction of the leverage ratio, common equity tier 1 capital, the liquidity coverage and net stable funding ratios, and the measurement of counterparty credit risk through the SACCR. However, the set of revisions that we're dealing with this spring cover a large number of chapters of the capital and liquidity guidelines, including, among other things, those related to credit, market, and operational risk. As such, the changes that we're consulting on will have a very wide reach and will impact every SIB and SMSB, excluding foreign bank branches, in some manner. I'd like to now draw your attention to some of the specific proposals that are encompassed within the consultation. Next slide, please. I don't plan to cover everything that's referenced within the table on this slide, but I will touch on a few topics that we expect will be of particular interest to institutions and other stakeholders. Firstly, I'd like to draw attention to a new draft SMSB capital liquidity requirements guideline. This guideline outlines the approach that's expected to be used for the segmentation of SMSBs into three categories. The criteria to be used for segmentation remain unchanged from our January 2020 consultative document and continues to allow for the use of OSFI judgment to recategorize an institution under certain circumstances. Within the credit risk requirements, attention is drawn to some changes that are proposed for the capital treatment of privately insured mortgages. OSFI's current capital rules assume a larger portion of the lender's risk is guaranteed than what is set out in the Protection of Residential Mortgage or Hypothecary Insurance Act, or PRIMIA. So we're consulting on proposed revisions to this capital treatment so that there's a greater alignment between CAR and PRIMIA. There are also a number of other changes proposed to the risk weights for residential mortgage lending to increase the risk sensitivity of these requirements, including the introduction of higher factors for investor-owned than for owner-occupied properties. We're also proposing some changes to the treatment of credit card exposures, with distinctions between the treatment for transactors and non-transactors. With respect to liquidity risk, we're proposing enhancements to the net cumulative cash flow requirements. The NCCF has been updated to improve recognition of cash flows related to asset growth, such as commitments, as well as address operational expenses. The calibration of NCCF commitment drawdowns has also been updated to recognize recent stress. In addition, a revised 3-day timeline for reporting the NCCF during periods of stress is being proposed. And the timeline for SMSBs to report regular monthly NCCF returns will be reduced from 30 days to 14 days outside of periods of stress, in line with OSFI's expectations for DSIBs. Next slide, please. I'll now provide a short overview of the approach that OSFI is proposing to use for the segmentation of SMSBs and the tailoring of minimum Pillar 1 capital and liquidity requirements for each category of institution. The table on this slide, which you might recognize from last year's consultative document, illustrates our proposed approach to segment SMSBs into three broad categories, which are the same as what we included in the proposals last year. As such, I won't provide a detailed overview of the framework today, but in a nutshell, SMSBs that have more than $10 billion in assets will be in Category 1. Category 2 will include institutions which have less than $10 billion in assets, but more than $100 million of total loans, while Category 3 will include institutions that have less than $100 million of loans. Notwithstanding these general criteria, OSFI will retain discretion to move an institution into a different category due to factors such as changes in an institution's activities that may not yet be reflected in its balance sheet, or instances where an SMSB's size-based category could result in capital and liquidity requirements that do not appropriately reflect its activities or risks. Given that many of you are already somewhat familiar with the overall framework, I thought it would be useful to draw your attention to the key changes that are included in the current consultation regarding the new guideline for your information and consideration. First, with respect to the risk-based capital requirements, we have proposed some changes to the new Simplified Standardized Approach, or SSA, for credit risk. Specifically, we've proposed to increase the maximum threshold for the SSA from $200 million to $500 million in exposure for each applicable asset class. In addition, we have also added the option for Category 1 SMSBs to use the SSA for credit risk if they meet the materiality threshold criteria. Second, for capital requirements for operational risk, we have now proposed that Category 1 SMSBs may apply to use the standardized approach if they have 5 years of high-quality internal operational loss data. In such cases, the internal loss multiplier would be floored at 1 until the institution has 10 years of high-quality data. Next, with respect to the proposals for liquidity requirements, one of the notable changes were some refinements to the definition of wholesale funding in the calculation of the threshold for determining whether the NSFR is applicable to a Category 1 SMSB. So on the whole, there were not a lot of significant changes to the proposals in comparison to what we discussed just over a year ago. However, there have been a number of refinements. To a great extent, these changes resulted from our careful consideration of input that we received from stakeholders, including FERFIs, during the course of last year's consultation. So thank you again for the suggestions and insights that you provided. Next slide, please. Some of the feedback that we've received from institutions during the course of last year's consultation included suggestions and requests to try to make some of our framework less complex and more user-friendly. We've taken this on board in a number of significant ways with respect to the content of the capital and liquidity frameworks, including, as I've noted, the introduction of a new simplified standardized approach for credit risk, a simplified standardized approach for operational risk, and a new simplified risk-based capital requirement, also a streamlined version of the NCCF, and the introduction of a new operating cash flow statement. Perhaps less notable, but still important, we've also tried to make the structure and format of the new SMSB guideline more user-friendly through the inclusion of a number of flowcharts and tables to help users navigate the underlying CAR, LAR, and leverage ratio requirements that pertain to their specific category of institution. The flowchart on this slide, for instance, is designed to help illustrate the application of some of the CAR guideline requirements for credit risk for Category 2 institutions. Other charts in the guideline help to illustrate requirements such as those for credit valuation adjustment risk, or the application of different approaches for counterparty credit risk, or the treatment of securitization exposures. In almost all cases, the flowcharts and tables are intended to help serve as a roadmap for the more extensive underlying capital or liquidity adequacy requirements guidelines. At just under 30 pages, we think that the new SMSB guideline is a useful starting point for stakeholders seeking to understand what the new capital and liquidity requirements will be for SMSBs, and address many of the suggestions that we've received during recent consultations. Next slide. I'll close by providing an overview of some of the key timelines for the work, which will take place between now and the implementation of the guidelines in Q1 2023. As previously noted, the consultations were kicked off on March 11th and will last for 12 weeks through June 4th. An exception to this will be the consultations on the Pillar 3 disclosure guideline, which will wrap up on July 2nd. A series of meetings on specific topics addressed in the consultation are in the process of being set up with the Canadian Bankers Association in late April and early May. In addition, we'll be organizing a series of what we're describing as virtual drop-in sessions for SMSBs during the weeks of May 17th and 24th. These meetings, which will be specific to SMSBs, will be a series of two-hour sessions, with each one covering a specific risk area or guideline. For instance, credit and leverage, liquidity, operational risk, and the new SMSB guideline. The intent behind these meetings is to provide an additional opportunity for SMSBs, which may or may not be members of the CBA or the Bank and Trust Companies Association, to share their views, pose questions, and hear issues raised by others. Of course, we always welcome the opportunity to engage directly with individual institutions and other stakeholders. In pursuit of Goal 4 of OSFI's strategic plan regarding transparency and preserving support from Canadians, you may have recently seen an announcement last week that there will be a technical briefing for the analyst community to address questions that they might have regarding the proposals. This call will take place on April 8th and will be targeted towards the financial analyst community, including credit rating agencies and investment analysts. FERFIs are welcome to register for the event. However, I would respectfully suggest that it will not be the best forum in which to suggest revisions to the proposals or raise questions pertaining to individual institutions. We will, of course, be happy to address questions and consider input from FERFIs during a number of other meetings that I've described, or of course, through bilateral discussions that we'd be pleased to help arrange. Questions or comments related to the draft guidelines, and by this I mean at following today's webcast, should be sent to consultations at osfi-bsif.gc.ca, which we will monitor daily. Concurrent with the consultations, OSFI is also undertaking a quantitative impact study, or QIS, to estimate the impact of the changes proposed in the draft CAR guideline and SMSB guideline related to capital. The purpose of this exercise is to gather specific information on how the proposed changes to the risk-based capital framework, or simplified risk-based capital ratio, could impact the capital requirements of DTIs. The results of the QIS, along with comments received from stakeholders as part of the public consultation, will be used to inform our policy decisions related to the final 2023 CAR guideline and new SMSB capital and liquidity requirements. The QIS also provides SMSBs with the tool to help assess the institution-specific impacts of the draft capital requirements. Next slide, please. As noted, one of the items that's included in the current consultation is a new Pillar 3 guideline related to disclosure requirements. Although this guideline will be applicable to the systemically important banks, we've included a number of questions in the cover letter, which pertain to small and medium-sized institutions. Responses to these questions will help to inform our development of a Pillar 3 guideline for SMSBs to be released for draft for consultation later this summer. Looking a bit further out, we're expecting to issue the final implementation versions of the CAR, LAR, Leverage, and SMSB guidelines in November of this year, with the regulatory return templates and instructions shortly thereafter. This will provide institutions approximately 1 year in advance of the implementation of the new requirements, as many institutions have stressed the importance of providing sufficient time to allow processes and data systems to be updated prior to going live in Q1 2023. An exception to these implementation timelines relates to the market risk and CVA requirements, which won't be implemented until the following year. This concludes my prepared remarks. I'm pleased to now pass the virtual microphone over to my colleague, Raluca Dobre, from our Market and Liquidity Risk Division. Thank you.
Thank you, Steve. And hello, everyone. It's my pleasure to be here today to share with you some of our experiences and lessons learned from last year's liquidity risk monitoring work and where we'll be focusing our efforts in the coming year. So if we turn to the next slide on key lessons from COVID-19, when we reflect on last year's experiences as the pandemic unfolded, three key themes emerged around the importance of reporting capabilities under stress, contingency funding plans, and stress testing programs. So I'm going to offer a few comments for these three themes. And I'll start with reporting capabilities under stress. As many of you experienced and may recall, in response to the unfolding of the pandemic in early March, we triggered a series of data requests and increased frequency for select data. For liquidity specifically, think of the LCR, the NCCF, the LAM, and in some cases, we introduced our cash flow calculators. The increase in frequency of some of these returns revealed weaknesses in a number of institutions' reporting production processes and opportunities to improve the timeliness and accuracy of liquidity submissions. OSFI appreciates the operational challenges and pressures that arose on resources, whether it's people or processes last year, but nevertheless, the capability and capacity to generate accurate and timely data, especially for monitoring liquidity risk exposures under stress, cannot be overstated. We're taking this opportunity to encourage institutions to test their production capabilities to ensure that they're able to meet our liquidity reporting requirements under stress. With respect to contingency funding plans, the pandemic enabled us to observe the CFP process unfold across the industry, and we observed varying activation times, with some institutions activating plans as early as February and some never activating them at all. CFP activation times were influenced by the design of the plans or key indicator thresholds that drove senior management's judgment to activate plans. In terms of design, there are those with an on and off switch approach, which tends to delay activation decisions, and those with escalating stages, where the stage increases as the severity of the stress increases. While activation levels varied, senior management teams were engaged in heightened monitoring during the early stages of the pandemic, revealing a potential misalignment between the institution's crisis management practices and their policy. So again, we encourage institutions to reflect on this past year's experience when reviewing CFP activation processes to ensure that their crisis management practices align with their policies, especially for those institutions that did not activate their plans, to revisit the appropriateness of plan design. Lastly, with respect to stress testing programs, as expected for the purposes of liquidity planning, the use of liquidity stress testing varied across institutions during the pandemic, with some continuing to evaluate various scenarios different from the ongoing COVID stress, while others really honed down, focused on sensitivity analysis specific to the pandemic stress itself. We also noted that the majority of institutions implicitly expected central banks would intervene in a market-wide stress. However, some institutions amended their stress testing assumptions to reflect explicit reliance on central bank funding. We want to remind institutions that many of these measures were extraordinary and targeted to the specific conditions of the pandemic. So when considering hypothetical stress scenarios that institutions maintain in their stress testing programs, institutions should continue to assess their liquidity vulnerabilities, assuming no access to public support. Lastly, assumptions play a key role in liquidity management. And we noted a number of assumptions were tested at the onset of the pandemic. Consider customer behavior and internal business line decisions that were revealed not to hold under stress. So again, it goes without saying, we're encouraging institutions to incorporate lessons learned from last year's events. If we turn to the next slide, in terms of looking ahead, monitoring. While we continue to be vigilant in our monitoring of market developments and liquidity risk, we have reduced the intensity of our monitoring as supported by the decrease in frequency for some of our reporting. Hopefully that's something you have felt and I suspect welcomed. One of the key outcomes of the pandemic that Jamie mentioned at the beginning has been an increase in liquidity positions, particularly driven by deposits, the growth of which has outpaced lending and contributed to stronger liquidity positions. Deposits are expected to continue to increase or remain stable as QE programs are maintained. We're monitoring this very closely and engaging institutions to understand customer behavior analysis being done around the assumed permanence or stability of these deposits that naturally feed into stress testing programs and assumptions. With the proportionality work that Steve spoke to, we are also evaluating our own internal data analytics capabilities to enable us to monitor effectively and scale our risk assessments based on the three SMSB segmented categories. With the proposed introduction of the three cash flow returns, it is our intention to eventually make these returns structured, which, as you know, includes validation rules. The importance of this ties back to our earlier observations around timely receipt of accurate information. This work also involves the recalibration of survival horizons. On this point, we are still in discussions on how best to undertake this calibration work. The feedback and impact assessments submitted by institutions through the consultation process will inform this work. So we encourage institutions to participate in this process. This concludes my remarks. Thank you for your time. It is my pleasure to introduce my colleague, Kenneth Leung. Ken is a director in our accounting policy division, and he will be speaking to you today about our work efforts on assurance as it relates to capital and liquidity requirements. So over to you, Ken. Thank you.
Great, thank you, Raluca. So today, what I'll do is I'll take us through an upcoming discussion paper on the assurance on capital leverage and liquidity returns. Next slide, please. So what I'll walk you through is some rationale as to why we're doing this project and what the objective is, and of course, what's within the scope of the project. So why now? Why are we looking at this? We're looking at this because there's an increasing complexity and evolving nature of upcoming changes, such as the Basel III reforms. And these reforms, they affect the regulatory returns, and they will highlight the need to further enhance assurance expectations. So as you may be aware, on the insurance side, we currently have insurance capital returns that are subject to annual external audit requirements. So what are we trying to do here? We're trying to look at the banking side, and we're seeking to align the assurance requirements so that they're similar across both industries that OSFI regulates. In terms of the objective, Again, we're trying to proactively enhance and align assurance expectations for banks so that OSFI can continue to have the confidence that key regulatory ratios and returns are prepared in accordance with OSFI's capital frameworks. This also supports OSFI's strategic goal number one by continuously looking at ways to improve the consistency, accuracy, and timeliness of risk assessments. When we look at what will be covered in terms of the scope, we're looking to explore ways on external audit, internal audit, and also attestation expectations relating to capital returns and ratios for banks. In terms of external audit, we know that this will provide an independent or third-party assurance to OSFI. With internal audit, the objective review by a party that is outside of the preparer of the capital returns is something that we're interested in. And it's also something that is, we understand, is not fully as independent as external audit, but yet very useful. And another way that we're looking at this is whether or not there should be senior management attestations associated with these returns. Now we are aware that these are based on self-assessment processes, so it may not give us as much independence and objectivity as the other two options just described. So next slide, please. In terms of timing, we are looking to issue a discussion paper next week. And of course it is a discussion paper. So it's a start of a process in which we hope to get feedback from the industry, namely from you, in terms of what our options are. Of course, in terms of a discussion paper, we wanted to put out a few options for consideration, and there will be a number of questions in which feedback will be received, and we will take that in terms of developing a draft guideline. So the consultation period will be for 10 weeks. So if we put it out for next week, we're looking at a tentative date of mid-June in terms of comment deadline. And of course, we will take this information and over the summer develop a draft guideline, which we hope to issue sometime in the fall of 2021. So with that, I will close off my remarks and I will turn it back to Brigitte for the virtual floor. Thank you.
Thank you, Ken, Raluca, and Steve. So now let's see if we have any questions from our viewers. But before we do so, I would like to introduce Robert Dugal, our Managing Director of our Credit Risk Division, who will also be joining us for this question period. So I'll pass it on to Ramin Burning from my group, who will facilitate the question period.
Merci, Brigitte. Bon après-midi.
Thanks, Brigitte. Good afternoon.
On Slido will be for Ken, and it is how will proportionality be applied to the assurance expectations?
Thank you, Ramin. Proportionality is important, certainly within this discussion paper. And as we've heard Steve and Raluca also mention before, there's also already initiatives going on for proportionality. So OSFI's initiative on the advancing of proportionality will be considered, and we're taking it in terms of complementing our discussion paper. And what we'll do is we'll certainly try to reflect the size, nature, complexity, and business activities of SMSBs. In the discussion paper that will be issued, there will be a specific question on proportionality. So we will be seeking specific feedback from you on that in terms of how we right size the discussion paper and how we right size the guidance going forward. Thank you.
Thank you, Ken. So the next question is, for Rob from Credit Risk Division. What observations do you have on the credit climate so far in COVID?
Thank you, Ramin. We can probably have a webcast just on this one question. As Jamie mentioned in the opening comments, we're definitely operating in a unique environment. What we've seen is credit performance remains benign, both in the retail and non-retail asset categories. And this is largely driven by the low rate environment coupled with the relief programs that we see out there. risk migration has also slowed, and we're not seeing a lot of ECL stage transfers occurring. So we're starting to see that stabilize as well. Impairment trends remain stable. Early in the pandemic, we did see some spikes. However, those have reversed as the economic prospects have improved. And corporate commercial borrowers are beginning to access the government programs and the liquid markets to recapitalize as needed. As home prices continue to appreciate, coupled with the current low rate environment, the degree of personal leverage continues to rise. So that's something we have to keep an eye on. As a result of the government relief programs, traditional retail credit metrics such as delinquencies, bureau scores, they may not be as robust as they were pre-pandemic, and that will have to be factored into some of the credit risk management strategies as well. So while the overall credit risk appears to have stabilized, there's still some uncertainties around the future of a couple areas. Household debt levels, commercial real estate, certain sectors such as the oil and gas and transportation, and inflation. So generally moving forward, there's a couple of areas that we will be watching very closely and expect lenders to be watching closely as well. As the economic forecasts improve, we're seeing releases of performing allowances. However, caution has to be considered here as the sustainability of the current positive environment in the face of wind down of government relief programs is still uncertain. As well, lenders will need to consider the risks associated with the elevated housing market and should ensure that the underwriting practices remain in compliance with OSFI's guideline B20, as well as the lender's own risk appetite. And areas of heightened risk include the sustainability of debt service levels and collateral valuations. I'll leave it at that, Ramin.
Okay, thank you for that. The next question is for Steve. Is it still the intention of OSFI not to increase the capital that SMSBs have to hold with the proposed changes?
Thanks very much, Ramin. Thanks for the question. So this is a question that we received quite frequently, actually, during the course of the consultations last year on the consultative document. So in the overall proportionality work, we've laid out a number of overarching principles that apply to the work. And these include that we improve the risk sensitivity of the framework and also try to achieve some greater simplicity within the framework as well. And we also indicate that we like to try to achieve or strike the right balance between these various principles. Now, in the context of the simplified approaches that we have introduced, the simplification approach does come at the expense of, you know, it is a more blunt approach and it is more conservative in many cases. So it is not an overarching objective for us that institutions need to hold more capital, not by any means whatsoever. However, there will be certain institutions that if they avail themselves of, some of the more simplified approaches, there could be some impacts in terms of the level of capital required. However, this is something that we've taken into consideration in trying to strike the right balance amongst the various aspects of the proposal. So, certainly if institutions have specific questions pertaining to their situation after assessing the proposals and going through the QIS exercise, we'd certainly like to engage in discussions with them to ensure that we have a mutual understanding of the objectives that we're trying to achieve and the impacts that it could have on individual business models. So thank you for your question.
Okay, Steve. So there's another question here for you. In terms of capital adequacy, how much of attention does OSFI pay to the financial institution's type of business rather than just asset size?
Thank you very much for the question. So certainly, the type of business is a very important consideration in terms of evaluating capital adequacy. I mean, the Pillar 1 requirements will be scaled, I guess, if you will, in the relation to the nature of an institution's business activities. The risk sensitivity that is built into those, will have a corresponding impact on the amount of capital that any institution needs to hold, whether it's concentrated in a residential mortgage lending model or a commercial mortgage lending model, for instance. So, as far as the proportionality framework, we have laid out a high level framework to have three main categories of institutions. So this is sort of the first step. However, you know, it also is important to consider not just the pillar one requirements, but the pillar two expectations, supervisory expectations that will be driven by institutions' own internal capital adequacy assessment processes. And so certainly the nature of an institution's business activities and the nature of the risks to which it is exposed will certainly have a corresponding effect on the level of capital that we would expect an institution to hold, as we would expect, you know, management teams would be mindful of that as well. So size is a factor in terms of the creation of the overarching pillar one framework and the simplicity or complexity, if you will, that is built into that. But when you get to the individual institution level, it will certainly be something we need to turn more attention towards the ICAP for those institutions. I hope that addresses the question.
Okay, thanks, Steve. There's some more questions for you. I'll put one forth. Can you expand on the revised liquidity proposals that banks include expense obligations? Would this not be taken into account in the original NCCF buffer? Actually, that could probably go for Raluca.
Yeah, maybe I can start and Steve can add. So what we're proposing here is operational expenses. So think salary, think office rent, think and really the driver here currently right now in the NCCF calculation, that is not a line item and is not factored into the survival horizon. Now institutions do have their own internal cash flow measures and they do modify assumptions. Some of them do increase, assume operational expenses and factor that into their NCCF survival horizons. But again, that's an internal metric. So we're proposing to explicitly include that in the regulatory NCCF cash flow metric. The driver really is that we have seen during stress times that operational expenses can have an impact. In BAU, generally it may be considered immaterial, but under stress, it's an important factor that will affect survival horizons. So that's really what's driving the desire to incorporate that into the NCCF. So I hope that answers your question.
Great, thank you, Raluca. Okay, so the next question is for Steve again. It says, you indicated that there would be revisions to risk weights on RESL based on type of ownership, owner-occupied versus investor?
Yes, thanks, Ramin. So yes, certainly there are some revisions within the CAR chapter related to credit risk pertaining to this. Listeners may be aware of the fact that there have been greater granularity of risk weights under the standardized approach for residential mortgage lending through the Basel III framework. We are adopting that in the Canadian context. And that basically specifies that rather than a flat 35% risk weight for uninsured residential mortgages, that there is, you know, a greater number of buckets for mortgages that are below 80% LTV. In addition, there is a factor that pertains to the nature of the mortgage for that, whether it is an owner-occupied property or whether it is investor-owned. So those details are laid out, I believe, in CAR Chapter 5, and largely based off of the Basel framework. So I hope that addresses the question. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Steve. One question for Ken. What is the goal of the assurance review? Minimize duplication, standardize the assurance report, another one?
Sure, thank you, Ramin, and thank you for the question. The ultimate goal here is two main things. It's to enhance current assurance expectations and also to align the two industries between banking and insurance. So when I say enhance, currently there's no external assurance right now on bank capital returns, nor leverage, nor liquidity. So that's something that we're exploring, right? Something that would possibly give OSFI some comfort that the numbers and ratios that we as supervisors rely on are done in a complete, accurate, and timely manner. So that's something that we're looking to explore. Again, on the insurance side, that's been done for a number of decades now. And it's something that isn't done on the banking side. And so we're looking to align the two. So I hope that answers the question.
Okay, thank you, Ken. And that's it for questions for this first section.
Thank you, Ramin. So now that there's no more questions, so we will take a quick 10-minute break, or 10 or a bit more, and we will reconvene at 2, sorry. Thank you. Welcome back. So our next speakers will talk about non-financial risks. Vlasios Melissanakis, Director of our Prudential Policy, will begin by discussing how OSFI's policy development process has evolved and provide some updates on some initiatives. Vlasios?
Thank you, Brigitte. So next slide, please. So before I give an update on some of our risk management guidance initiatives, I think it's important to articulate a little bit some changes that have occurred at OSFI over the past few years. So I need to take you through a little bit of the evolution of policy development at OSFI. And if you go back to the 2008 financial crisis, you will remember that following that crisis, OSFI, among other regulators, frantically revised many, many guidelines, many policies to sort of elevate the regulatory regime of every jurisdiction to be fit for purpose following the crisis. Now, all of that, of course, came to an end, all of those reforms following a decade of hard work. And as we entered into a more stable environment, we at OSFI felt that we needed to rethink sort of our policy development process to be a little bit more deliberative, a little bit more transparent, be a little bit more methodical about our policy making, so that in fact it was much more responsive to the industry's needs. So you will notice that in the past couple of years, there's been some marked changes in the way we've been doing things at OSFI. Much earlier and more enhanced engagement with stakeholders on emerging policy issues. And you will have noticed the past year or so, we've issued a number of discussion papers. My colleague, Steve Bevington, Kenneth Young, have mentioned a couple of them. And these discussion papers are, or what we call green papers here in Ottawa, are high-level idea starters, conversation starters. So we are involving industry much earlier in the process than we did before. And you will see a number of these discussion papers in a number of areas. I'll talk about a few of them in a couple of minutes. But we also have consultative documents or white papers, we call them here in Ottawa, where we offer specific policy proposals. And then of course we have draft guidance. So there's a number of occasions where industry can offer their input, a number of consultation processes. And these are designed very deliberately to tease out some of the unique issues, for example, small banks versus large banks. This is very deliberate on our part. In line with that, we've also increased our transparency in the policy process. So if you will recall, in September, we issued a near-term plan, which was published alongside a speech by Assistant Superintendent Bengali. And this near-term plan laid out essentially all of the policy initiatives for the year to come, along with very specific timelines. We intend that document to be an annual publication, and so you should expect another such publication at some point in the spring. And then finally, we've been making greater use of communications tools. Case in point, today's session. But we've also been publishing more and more a number of Q's and A's. We've been providing information sheets, the guideline B20 information sheet is a good example, more webinars, roundtables, and industry information sessions, all designed to equip industry in understanding OSFI's approach, OSFI's thinking, and future plans. And so the idea here is to end up with regulation that is well-grounded and responsive. Next slide, please. So with that in mind, we issued a discussion paper on technology risk for consultation in September of 2020. And this was a 3-month consultation, which included, in fact, information sessions and roundtables with industry, and that concluded in December of 2020. This paper covered a number of areas, all aspects of technology from a prudential perspective. It looked at operational risk and resilience, cybersecurity, third-party risk, models risk, and data risk. That's a large and comprehensive look at technology risk. And we are still assessing the feedback that we received from industry. We received 50 submissions from industry, which was really good and very helpful to us in developing our policy. In the coming months, in the spring, we will be announcing our next steps. And the next steps could include the issuance of new guidance in specific areas, amendments to existing guidance, or potentially further discussion papers or consultative documents. Next slide, please. Just a few other initiatives. We issued draft guideline E4, which looks at branches, for consultation in October 2020. And this guideline was in the making for many years, was put on hold during the development of the corporate governance guideline, was relaunched, was once again put on hold because of COVID-19. We managed to complete a consultation process, and now we are at last ready to issue a final guideline at some point in June. In meeting with our proposal, it will be principles-based, significantly streamlined, and the focus will be on the foreign entity and not on the principal officer. And it will entail the amendment of other guidance pieces at OSFI that refer to branch requirements. The idea is to assemble all of the risk management requirements, not the collateral requirements, that's very different, but all of the risk management requirements into one guideline, one consolidated principles-based, outcomes-based guideline E4. And as I said, that should be out in June of this year. And finally, just earlier this year, we issued a discussion paper on climate-related risks. And here, the discussion paper is designed to get your views on how banks define, identify, measure, and build resilience to climate-related risks. And more specifically, the paper looks at physical transition and liability risks. We're still doing quite a bit of work in this area to understand a lot of these issues ourselves, and we're hoping to get valuable feedback from industry to build our policy position on this in this area. Now, in this, this could lead to new guidance. Again, it could mean amendments to existing guidance, but it may also mean that there are no changes or there is no new guidance, but instead we'd be looking to enhanced supervision or all of the above. At this point, we don't know, but that will it will be valuable to us to hear what you have to say. Thank you. With that, I will turn it over to my colleague, Mohammed Al-Bastami, Managing Director of the Technology Risk Division.
Thank you so much, Vlasios. Good afternoon, everyone. Good morning to anyone joining us on the West Coast. My name is Mohammed Al-Bustami, and I'm the Managing Director of the Technology Risk Division. I'm going to give a very brief update on some of the themes and the trends that we've been observing in the past year when it comes to cyber risk and technology risk. Next slide. So in terms of the threat landscape, from an industry perspective, a few things to highlight. We continue to see phishing campaigns, and most of them during the pandemic year has transitioned to utilize themes and lures related to COVID-19, and in some cases even to government relief program themes to try to entice potential victims to click and open these emails. Additionally, we've seen third-party supplier attacks or supply chain attacks, usually in the form of ransomware type attack. Additionally, we continue to see distributed denial of service attack, and that the trend that resurged this year is the trend of extortion denial of service attacks, which again includes a ransom note when the attackers perform these attacks. And finally, we continue to see credential stuffing type attacks that aim to harvest personal information like usernames, emails, passwords, etc. Next slide. When we bring it more closer to home, what are some of the trends that we observe across our financial institutions and the SMSB portfolio? Third-party cyber incidents, where these were very apparent and pretty much continuous through the year. Some are very widely and publicized that are mentioned on the slide, like the most recent SolarWinds attack, Acilion, Finastra, and Cognizant earlier in the year, as I mentioned, increased in the themes of phishing attack, taking advantage of the COVID-19 theme and the distributed denial of service. When we pivot into the technology aspect of things in the next slide, we notice that a lot of activity has taken place in our institutions. For example, a rapid ramp up of work from home and leveraging work from home tools and technologies, reprioritization of IT projects, whether it's network stability, government programs, digitization and automation, and finally, increased use of communication collaboration tools. So how does that reflect in terms of potential risks? So on the next slide, again, due to these items that I spoke about, you can see a currency of vulnerability and patch management program. These continue to be an item that we closely monitor due to the expansion of network systems and work from home tools. Additionally, potential loss of data, these endpoints due to lack of controls, use of cloud-based collaboration tool and unauthorized access and data leakage, and finally, technology debt and IT currency. And if we want to even bring in terms, how does that reflect in terms of incidents into the next slides? This is usually, we did this last year, so you might be familiar, but this is the more recent look of the incidents. And these are incidents that we get through our advisory, the technology and cyber incident advisory, with more reflective and focused on the SMSB space. So you can see, we've received notification related, as I mentioned, to some third-party breaches. However, we also received notification in relation to some ATM jackpotting attacks, distributed denial of service, phishing, and credential stolen. And in the past year, we have received a total of 51 reported incident through our incident advisory. Roughly around 50% of those came from an SMSB institution. And that summarized and finished my remarks for the day. And I'll pass it off to Elspeth Bowler, who's going to speak to you about operational risk management and operational resilience.
Thank you, Mo. And today I'm going to highlight some of the key operational risks that were elevated by COVID, and also what insights COVID has given OSFI regarding the status of operational resilience at the banks we supervise. And then I'll conclude with what's next in terms of advancing our supervision of operational resilience and operational risk. Next slide. So this slide, while it's not exhaustive, does highlight some of the key operational risks that were elevated by COVID. Just starting at the far left, business continuity has been an area of focus as most banks activated their business continuity plans last March. Many of these plans were successfully deployed, but did require significant adaptation as many of them relied on disaster recovery sites that were unsuited to a work from home environment. Our current priority is to ensure that the plans continue to be tested and updated as further disruptions, both related and unrelated to the pandemic, could occur. Changes introduced during the pandemic to address some of the challenges related to work from home, from the work from home environment, health, and as Mohammed alluded to, the technology changes are leading to new processes such as electronic sign-offs and remote meetings. And these require new oversight and control methods. These changes also included many manual workarounds and shifting of resources in order to keep business operations functioning. Looking forward, it will be important for banks to consider how change management is implemented across their organization in order to manage these new processes and controls. Change management will also be required as banks move into the new normal, as we now call it. Fraud is also an area that was highlighted during COVID, as fraud actors, we found fraud actors could quickly change their tactics in an attempt to take advantage of these new circumstances. And the banks are likely to be more vulnerable to fraud because of potentially less stringent or untested controls that have been implemented to accommodate remote working. Moving to third party, financial institutions are becoming increasingly reliant on third parties for critical services and activities. Many of these third party suppliers have also shifted to a work from home environment. And this has resulted in exemptions being granted to service level agreements and also required new oversight controls and standards. The banks should ensure that they have robust monitoring frameworks in place, including relevant KRIs to ensure that third-party risk is adequately managed in this new working environment. And finally, transaction processing. Banks have generally been able to respond to the pandemic challenges through deployment of additional resources, but this still remains an area of focus for us as customer support measures begin to unwind and banks transition to the new normal. Now, you notice at the bottom, there's an arrow across operational resilience, and this really cuts across all operational risks. And it's really, we define it as the ability of a financial institution to deliver critical operations through significant disruptions. While we believe that the Canadian financial system has shown a high degree of operational resilience since the beginning of the pandemic, its ability to deliver critical services during a very prolonged period of operational disruption and under different operating environments will be tested in the months ahead as potentially other disruptions occur. So next slide. So what's next? First of all, we will continue to monitor banks' adaption to the work from home environment, as well as return to office plans. Given the elevated risks related to third-party relationships, we will also continue to conduct selective in-depth reviews of third-party risk management processes. And finally, we will continue to clarify our supervisory approach to operational resilience and will remain engaged with the international community. And now I'm going to turn it over to Brigitte for the question and answer period.
Thank you, Elsbeth, Mo, and Vlasios. So I see that there's a few questions on Slido, so I will ask Hamin again to lead us through those questions.
Okay, so there's a couple of questions related to the E4 guideline for Vlasios. So I'll read the first one. Can industry expect that the final version of the E4 guideline is strongly aligned with the draft version that was circulated?
Yes, the final version will not be substantially different from the one that we consulted on. There was broad support from the industry in the proposed approach, sort of the principles-based, right-sized approach. And there were a number of comments relating to some technical details, and we will be clarifying some of those in the revised guideline. But largely, the approach is not changing.
Okay, thank you. And for the second question, what is, let's see here, with the finalization of E4 guideline, what are the other associated guidelines that would be impacted?
I believe there are 9 guidelines, other OSFI guidelines, which have minor references to guideline E4B in relation to the principal officer. They're very minor references, and some of these go back to more than a decade old. Some of them go back to the 90s, in fact. So we're cleaning all of that up. They're very minor references, but I believe it's about 9 guidelines.
Okay, thank you, Vlasios. Next question is for Mohammed. Can you elaborate more about the corporate VPN endpoints risks that you are seeing in terms of trends from an IT risk management perspective?
Sure, and it's an interesting one because if we look at it from end to end, there's multiple areas that risks and potential threats arise from this implementation, starting from the network infrastructure perspective. When it comes to your VPN infrastructure, we've seen in the past year a lot of attacks and vulnerabilities targeting VPN infrastructure like Citrix and Pulse VPN, and those attacks usually led either to a ransomware attack or to information disclosure attacks. And when we bring it closer to the endpoint perspective, it's usually around data leakage prevention and potential leakage of data. So ensuring that there is controls in place to ensure that the data and the information is properly protected as employees has moved to working from home. So the same level of controls is not the same as institution would have back at the office. So it's ensuring during that transition that appropriate controls and mitigating controls are in place to ensure no data leakage, information leakage is happening.
Okay, thank you. And you touched upon this. There's another question here. Has OSFI seen any increases in insider risk, fraud, as a result of the working from home environment across institutions?
So I'll probably pass to Elsbeth to better answer this question in terms of her area of focus.
Sure. I would say that while there has been fraud, there has not been an extreme increase in the level of fraud. Having said that, you only know what you know, and but what has come out so far, while there have been cases of fraud, if you look at it compared to prior years, it's probably not significantly more.
Okay, thank you. Another question for you, Elsbeth. Does OSFI see improving operational resilience as a priority?
I think the short answer is yes. Historically, we've emphasized the importance of business continuity plans. However, in today's environment, with increasing reliance on technology, the ability to deliver critical operations through disruption is particularly important, and hence we're shifting our focus more to an operational resilience focus.
Okay, Okay, thank you. Another one for you. What is the current status on the review of guideline B10, material outsourcing arrangements?
Okay, so I will say something and then turn it over to Palacios if he wants to add something as well. We're currently in the process of reviewing some of the feedback we got from the third party study, as well as the TECRIS paper, looking at that in terms of what it means in terms of what we would like to update, in addition to some of the observations we've met. And we're currently really in the planning process as to exact timing. I don't know, Palacios, if you want to add anything as well.
Just to add that we will be announcing what those next steps are coming out of the technology risk consultation, which involves, B10 was a part of that, or it was closely linked with that. We will be announcing the results and the next steps in the months to come, so likely in the spring, we're hoping.
Thank you, Vlasios and Elspeth. And that's all the questions we have for this section.
Thank you, Ramin. So there's no more questions, so we'll move on to the last segment of our agenda, which is on data. And to lead this part, to begin this part of the agenda, I would like to introduce Ardeen Wertheim. Ardeen's managing director in the small and medium-sized banking group. And she will speak about data. Ardeen, over to you.
Thank you. Good afternoon. Over the last 12 months, we've asked a lot of you in terms of data, both quantitative and qualitative, and in the middle of the COVID pandemic. For supervision, data is obviously vital for everything we do. For quantitative information, we are, however, hampered by the fact that many of our regulatory returns, for example, credit ones, are quarterly, and getting information 45 days after quarter end is too dated, especially during times of stress. So what have we done? Last year, we created a number of questionnaires on various risks that soon morphed into ad hoc data calls on RESL, CRE, corporate and commercial, credit cards, as well as foreign bank branches. A summary of some of these themes is displayed on the word cloud, next page please, that you see here. This information covered a broad spectrum, loan portfolio details, geography, deferrals, delinquencies, defaults, as well as ECL information, to name a few. The ad hoc data is received monthly from many of you and are around 100 data points, are verified and often cross-checked against regulatory returns, which sometimes involves having to go back to you as errors continue. We also asked some of you to do stress testing, or we spoke with your parent organization, either domestically or internationally. And for others, we took a deeper look at the elements of your own stress testing models to better understand their depth and breadth. So how do we use this data? We use this information for obvious things such as deeper analysis, but also for our own stress testing, such as various credit stresses and their impact on capital under different economic scenarios, recovery scenarios. The deferral information received from you last year was used extensively for this. The data helps OSFI better understand your exposure to and resilience to various risks. In addition, our partners at CDIC, Bank of Canada, and Department of Finance also rely on OSFI's timely information to assess the risks in the SMSB portfolio for their own work. So that was 2020. Next slide, please. Going forward, and for 2021, our information needs are the same. So these ad hoc requests will continue for both qualitative and quantitative information. Data that is timely, accurate, and has both depth and breadth is essential for OSFI to understand your institution's resilience to both financial and non-financial risks. We will be looking at returns in more detail, using new technology to mine the data as we never have before, at a foundational level to ensure they are complete, accurate, and that they reconcile across returns, to conduct sensitivity analysis, and to do more peer comparisons to identify outliers. We will continue to use a variety of mediums to obtain information. This month, some of you received a questionnaire on RESL. There will be additional ones coming, and others may receive ones on CRE, corporate and commercial, or operational or technology risks, to name a few. Some of these questionnaires will be industry-wide and also include DSIBs, and some will just be for SMSB. For the ad hoc data credit calls, we are going deeper by industry to subsector categories. For example, we're asking information not just on construction or RESL, but the types of construction lending you are doing or the types of borrowers you have in RESL. For our RESL origination transactional data calls, we'll be looking to expand this to the whole RESL portfolio. One of our most extensive sources of data is, of course, file reviews. And this year, your institution may or may not get a request with minimal notice for a focused file review of a particular credit sector. It could be RESL, CRE, or corporate commercial. Other sources of information will continue to be used, including external auditors, parent companies, foreign regulators, and so on. Through analytics, we want to better understand you, your corporate DNA, if you will. Data analysis helps highlight anomalies, which is then the start of a conversation with you to determine the story behind the numbers, or the why, the where, and how long. Of course, OSFI is very aware that ad hoc requests and questionnaires are a dated and inefficient way of collecting data, both for you and for us. We are looking at ways to change this, and in 2021, we will explore various means to do so in order to eliminate these laborious asks. In the 21st century, we do expect financial institutions to be able to provide information at a sufficient level of granularity across a spectrum of risks and in a timely and accurate fashion. The future is data and technology. And here to speak to you about that future is Andrew Miller, OSFI's Chief Data Officer.
Thank you, Ardine. Good afternoon, everyone. As Ardine mentioned, I'm Andrew Miller, the Chief Data Officer at OSFI and head up our Risk Data and Analytics Division. For some background, my purview is not externally focused from a supervisory perspective, but looking internally to the way that OSFI uses and draws value from data. Ardine and others today have spoken about the need for better data. And the flip side of that equation is OSFI investing in its own data management and analytical capabilities. And on that front, this is a key area of focus for our organization and a top priority for OSFI. We're not unlike any other organization that is focusing in on our data management and analytical capabilities. It is happening within your firms. It is happening across the federal government. And certainly it is happening at OSFI. And so what I wanted to do today is provide a brief insight into our current plans and some of our forward-looking views in this area. Next slide, please. So to start with, a high-level overview of what our data strategy is. If you could advance ahead. Ultimately, what we are trying to do is improve the efficiency and efficacy of our regulatory mandate, and to do so using modern tools and skill sets to transform data into analytical insights. And there's three key components to this data strategy. Can we move to the next area? Thank you. So creating a strong data foundation means developing robust practices to process and protect data that we collect at OSFI. This is a very important area and will give us a foundation for working with that information in new ways. Next, move ahead. Analytics transformation is another area of focus for us. And this is about taking that data that we have and using it in new ways, new skill sets, new applications, and new tools. And then finally, if you move ahead, we also understand that OSFI is an important part of a data ecosystem. So working strategically with our key stakeholders, both across government and beyond with our institutions, is another key area that will drive our data strategy forward. Next slide. So with that broad overview in place, what I wanted to do is make it a little bit more tangible and to talk a little bit about our data architecture, both past, present, and future. If we can go to the next section. So if you look at our data collection today, historically, it has come in through, as was mentioned, our regulatory return system, more structured returns, as well as ad hoc data calls. Next up. We've already spoken to some of the issues that this can create in terms of the data being more aggregated, not as timely, and harder to assess the data quality. Next step, please. That flows into legacy databases. And if we could go all the way through here. Great, I think one more. OSFI does its own manual cleansing, has done its own manual cleansing in terms of that information. There's usually a lot of back and forth with institutions. And historically, we've been using more legacy toolkits. If we go to the next section, maybe all the way through, please. Thank you. What we've been doing over the last couple of years is focusing and investing on what I would call more of our top of stack infrastructure and technologies. We're increasingly using cloud infrastructure with Government of Canada security standards. We're looking to leverage new processes and tools to automate our data transformation and data cleansing routines. We are using more modern toolkits and platforms when it comes to reporting and basic reporting and BI and analytical outcomes. And increasingly, we have developing advanced analytical skill sets. Yes, even OSFI has a burgeoning data science team. And so what we've been doing is really trying to get better at the way we work with this information for our supervisory and regulatory teams. Can we go to the next section, please? Maybe go all the way through. Great. So while we are also looking at the way we increase and enhance our internal capabilities around data management and analytics, it's also important to look at, as was mentioned before, how we can better collect data at source. And so that means looking at our data collection systems and finding a way to make them more modern, efficient, and effective in terms of how we collect, manage, and share. And if we do that effectively, we can contribute to a more modern regulatory reporting ecosystem in Canada. But as we look at this space, there's a couple areas that we are going to be focusing in on and have to address. From a technical perspective, what does the architecture look like in a modern regulatory reporting and collection system landscape? Is it an evolution away from our regulatory return system? And how do we make that better? How do we further use more flexible architectures like APIs, application programming interfaces, so we can be more dynamic in the ways that we collect information and more flexible when changes are needed? From a data perspective, how can we use these opportunities to address some data quality issues? How can common input layers and industry data standards play a role in that? How can technology, again, play a role in more automated checks and balances for data quality? And from a process perspective, how can we make it more efficient and effective in terms of the interaction between OSFI and institutions, in terms of the flow of information back and forth? How can we make instructions and definitions clearer? These are areas that with modern data collection systems and approaches, we think we can make this process much more efficient. And so overall, you can see what we're trying to do here at OSFI is focus in on and invest in our own data management capabilities. In doing so, we think this will create benefits, again, for the regulatory reporting framework and regime and ecosystem in Canada, of which OSFI plays an important role. It is still early days as we evolve these technologies moving forward. But as we continue to make progress, we endeavor to do so in a coordinated, open, and balanced way, as we would always do. So I think I'm going to pause there, Brigitte, and perhaps pass it back to you for some questions.
Thank you, Andrew. So we will move to questions on data. Ramin, do we have any questions from our viewers at this point?
We have no questions at this moment for this section.
Okay, so it seems like we will not have questions on this segment. So if there's no more questions, I would like to thank you for taking the time out of your busy schedule to join us and participate in this webinar. I would also like to thank all the presenters as well as my OSFI colleague who helped to organize this event. We do hope that you have found this webcast of value. And this afternoon, you will receive an online evaluation by email asking for your feedback. And you, I just want to stress that your input is important to us. So please take a few moments and let us know if what you liked about today's session and how we can improve, or any ideas you have for next time. This webcast is for you, so please take this opportunity to let us know what you want out of this session. And as I mentioned earlier, if you weren't able to answer your question, we will circulate a list of those questions and the response via email as necessary. The recording of today's session will be available on our YouTube channel in the coming weeks, and we will email you when the link is when it's ready. I would like to thank you again and enjoy the rest of the day. Thank you.